Dear colleagues and friends, welcome to today's combustion webinar. It's my great pleasure and honor to introduce you our speaker, Professor Peter Glarborg. Professor Peter Glarborg is a professor of chemical engineering at the Technical University of Denmark, where he has taught since 1996. Peter is an associate editor of Combustion Flame, and he was program co-chair for the 36th International Combustion Symposium in Seoul in 2016. Peter has published about 300 research articles in archived journals. He is working broadly in the field of combustion and harmful emission control, with special emphasis on developing detailed reaction mechanisms for high temperature gas phase kinetics. And with that, I would like to welcome Peter, and thank you very much for your time, and the podium is yours.
Thank you very much, and thank you for inviting me to do this webinar. So the topic is, as you can see, technical and kinetic challenges in using ammonia as a carbon-free energy carrier. So this is a drawing of what is perhaps the situation on the Earth at the moment, that we may be approaching a critical situation with the climate due to the greenhouse impact. And a lot of the research in the combustion community is directed at improving this situation. So one future scenario to reduce the CO2 emissions is to reserve biomass used for fuel, for jet fuel production. The automotive area can be run on batteries or perhaps fuel cells. But there are a number of energy requiring units that cannot run on batteries. We will have probably for a longer time a need for a thermal plant for backup, and the whole maritime sector also contributes significantly to the CO2 emission. So the topic here today for me has been motivated by the challenges in the maritime sector. So there's a lot of discussion currently about the maritime sector, how to reduce the CO2 footprint. And it would be great to say you can free the energy from carbon by using non-carbon fuels. And the fuels that have been thought about, carbon-free fuels, is mainly hydrogen and ammonia. Hydrogen is quite challenging to store in large amounts. So ammonia is currently seen as the most promising carbon-free energy carrier for the maritime sector. And the main energy solutions and other engine manufacturers are developing engines that are fueled by ammonia. So why choose ammonia? It's produced fairly easily, not necessarily cheaply, but easily from hydrogen. And it already is used worldwide as a fertilizer or for refrigeration or as a base chemical. And for the same reason, there's a worldwide storage and delivery system in place. So that makes ammonia an attractive carbon-free fuel. For the maritime sector, the main, competitive or alternative fuel could be green methanol, which is expected to be slightly more expensive than green ammonia. But at the moment, the large engines in the maritime sector are running mostly on diesel fuel, and to some extent, methanol or natural gas. When you make a fuel switch, you have to consider a number of concerns. You need to address sustainability, fuel handling and pretreatment, combustion properties, operational concerns such as deposition and corrosion, harmful emissions, and any solid residues that you have from the combustion process. A significant number of these challenges, they are a concern when you want to switch to ammonia. There are issues about sustainability, about fuel handling. The combustion properties is a significant concern. There are some operational concerns in terms of corrosion. And then there's the issue about emissions. So in the first part of my talk here, I will address some of these concerns. So if it should make sense to switch to ammonia as a fuel, it needs to be green ammonia, because otherwise it doesn't make a lot of sense to use ammonia from based on natural gas conversion. And you can make green ammonia where you produce power in a sustainable way from wind power or solar power. You have an electrolysis process to produce hydrogen, and then you have a catalytic process where you make hydrogen react with nitrogen over a catalyst. So this is a green ammonia. There are a few issues about that, in addition to the price, which will be significantly larger than so-called black ammonia. There's also the availability, which is currently significantly less than required. There's not a lot of green ammonia on the market. Another concern for ammonia is the fuel handling. So if we look here at the hazard assessment taken from the review by Valera Medina and co-workers, we see that the concerns that we normally have with fuels, which is mostly focused on fire issues or explosion hazards, they are not present for ammonia, because ammonia is such a terrible fuel. But ammonia is a troublesome fuel in terms of the toxicity. So the hazards associated with the use of ammonia is mainly related to the requirements for safety. And that is a different it's a different concern, different challenge from what we are used to when we have fuel switching. I mentioned a couple of times that the combustion properties of ammonia is not very attractive. You can say the left-hand side here shows the measured ignition delay time at high pressure for a slightly lean mixture of ammonia and oxygen in a diluent. And the ignition delay times for ammonia, you see here, is significantly longer than you can accept in even a large diesel engine. Furthermore, once you have ignited the ammonia, it doesn't combust readily. The laminar flame speed is about six times lower than that of methane, which is already not a very reactive fuel, and this is a concern. So the combustion properties of ammonia is one of the major challenges in switching to ammonia as a fuel. Emissions, the final concern here. When you oxidize ammonia, you can form nitrogen oxides, NO and NO2, but you can also form N2O. We know that we can usually deal with NO emissions by downstream catalytic cleaning. But N2O is a strong greenhouse gas, and it's not easily dealt with by catalytic cleaning, because that process requires temperatures which in some cases would be prohibitive in the exhaust. So nitrous oxide is a major concern and could be a showstopper for certain technical use of ammonia as a fuel. So what is the situation inside a large two-stroke marine diesel engine? Let's take a look at the short video here from MAN Energy Solutions. These two-stroke engines, they have cylinders that are so large that that a person can easily stand inside them. We can see it's a strongly turbulent diffusion flame that is created, and it's a very complex process with a combination of turbulent flow, transient conditions, high pressure, and the interaction with turbulence. So how do we deal with supporting the industry in developing these engines? Well, our work here at DTU has mainly been focused on lab scale experiments and development of kinetic models, also supported by theory. We have some semi-industrial scale facilities, but when it comes to these large two-stroke engines, it doesn't make a lot of sense to downscale them. So in order to carry the knowledge from the more fundamental work to the practical application, CFD is the most attractive way of extrapolating to industry. So what we are doing is that we are working on supplying models, chemical models for the ammonia combustion kinetics. And this is indeed important because ammonia, partly because ammonia is such a pure fuel that it gets challenging to use it in an engine, and also because ammonia oxidation gives rise to NOx formation and N2O. And because these engines are so large and very expensive to run as test engines, modeling is a quite important tool in design and optimization. Usually in CFD simulations, the modelers prefer very simple schemes, but global reaction schemes that often are useful for turbulent diffusion flames, they are not really useful for ammonia because of the complexity of the kinetics, particularly in terms of the selectivity of reaction to form different end products. So there's a need to develop and simplify reliable reaction mechanism for ammonia combustion. A few years ago, I was involved in a review paper on nitrogen chemistry in combustion. And there was a part of that dealing with ammonia modeling. So if we take a status as it was in year 2018, the model for ammonia oxidation actually worked fairly well. Reasonable agreement with shop tube ignition delays, agreement with flow reactor experiments with and without the presence of NO, and agreement with low pressure premixed flame structure experiments. So it looked fairly well as a starting point when extrapolating to other conditions relevant for ammonia as a fuel. But we should pay attention to the fact that previous work on ammonia oxidation kinetics were motivated by ammonia as a fuel volatile component that could lead to formation of nitrogen oxides. So previous work on ammonia chemistry was mostly focused on the formation of NOx or use of ammonia to control emissions of NOx in the thermal denox process. And the reaction conditions of interest were very small amounts of ammonia concentration or of ammonia, the radical pool being mainly controlled by the fuel oxidation chemistry, and the experiments were typically at atmospheric pressure. So these conditions are quite different from the conditions that we have in an engine. So in terms of the modeling challenges, we need to predict for both ammonia and ammonia co-fuel mixtures at high pressure, the ignition properties, flame speed, post-ignition oxidation rate, and emissions. And the co-fuel could be anything from hydrogen over alcohols and ethers to diesel or diesel surrogates. So it's a very wide range of chemistry we're actually looking into here. Because of the interest in ammonia as a fuel, there has been a huge amount of work on ammonia oxidation since 2018. And this slide only captures some of the work done in 2019 and 2020 on ignition delays and shock tubes and rapid compression machines and on flame speed. It doesn't even cover the more recent work. What I have chosen to do in this talk is to use tunnel vision. So I will mainly focus on the work that that we have been involved in here at DTU. So just a few words on how we go about developing a detailed chemical kinetic model. For start, you try to compile the best available species and reaction-specific data. So there could be thermodynamic properties and rate constant for reactions based on measurements, theory, and in the absence of those from estimation rules. And once you have compiled your model, you can compare modeling predictions with the best available so-called global experimental data, that means non-reaction specific, typically ignition delays or flame speed or experiments where you have detailed concentration profiles. And at this point, probably you will realize that your model is not working as well as you wanted it to. And then you have two different pathways to go. You can go for a so-called first principles model, where you stick to what you consider the best rate constants that are available, or you can move towards an engineering model where your emphasis is more on obtaining a satisfactory agreement with the experiment so the model can be utilized for industrial purposes. If you look at these two approaches, the first principle models where you stick to what you consider the most accurate rate constant for each reaction, I would consider that scientifically solid, and it represents the present understanding of the chemistry. But it often provides a lower accuracy compared to engineering models. The engineering model has been optimized to improve agreement. And that means that at least for the optimized regime, it provides a higher accuracy. Eventually, the accuracy of the two approaches will be the same as the chemistry is understood better and better. One issue with the engineering models are that they tend to disguise the scientific issues because you obtain a good agreement with the experiments that you're comparing your modeling with, and then it looks like all the problems are solved. I'll get back to this issue a little bit in a little while. Well, here's a figure that shows our prediction for the laminar flame speed of ammonia compared to various experimental data. So there are different models here. Most of them work fairly well, and the model from our review paper works spectacularly bad compared to everybody else's model. We could fix this problem by modifying some of the rate constants, but we couldn't be sure which of the rate constants that we should modify. So our choice was to leave it as is, and then through the development of the model, slowly, hopefully get an improved agreement with the experiment. So we are trying to stick to the first principles approach, even though it's somewhat a gray area, you can say. So the way we go about developing the model is that we develop it through comparison with experimental data on ignition, oxidation. We support the model development by theory, and we can look at specific subsets of the model to get a better understanding of that. And then finally, we can use perturbation as a method. If we perturb the experiments, in a certain way by adding a component, we can learn things about the ammonia chemistry. So let me run through briefly these approaches. So over the last few years, we have been involved in, we have collaborated with groups that have done theoretical calculations for a number of the key reactions. A lot of the work has been together with Stephen Klippenstein from Argonne National Lab. And here are some of the key reactions that he has been looking at. If you look at these reactions, they have something in common. They are multiple well, multiple product channel reactions, which are very difficult to characterize completely by experiment. So the dependence on temperature and pressure over a wide range can almost only come from theory. And what Stephen has contributed with is mainly a change of our thinking of these reactions. The NH2 plus HO2 turned out to be terminating, strongly terminating instead of lastly propagating. The NH2 plus HNO turned out to be much faster than previously thought. And NH2 plus O turned out to have a roaming channel to NO plus H2, which is strongly terminating. So these findings provide some disruption in our understanding of the chemical kinetics. Now, the first principle model is not so sensitive to this disruption because we are used to the accuracy going up and down. But if you have carefully optimized your model, then you are left with a new optimization. We have also been looking at subsets of the amine chemistry, mostly the chemistry occurring under pyrolysis. So we have taken data from the literature, here shock tube measurements from Altoreifi et al. And other data, and compared with modeling prediction for this specific subset, and combined that with theory here for the ammonia dissociation, or rather the recombination of NH2 plus H. This approach has led us to propose an updated rate constant for specific reactions. One of those reactions is the NH3 plus NH2 reaction, which has been proposed to be quite important to explain a number of data from jet-stirred reactors and flow reactors. But by reanalyzing the literature data here from flow reactors and from shock tube data, we confirm that possibly, as predicted by theory, this rate constant is too slow to be of any practical significance. As you go up in concentration using ammonia as a fuel, you will have local reducing conditions where you can form higher amines, like, for instance, N2H4. So we have also been looking at data for that to improve our understanding of this chemistry. Another way to expand our knowledge of the amine chemistry is to perturb it in different ways. One way is to add a fuel that will change the radical pool composition, and it can also move the chemistry to a different temperature regime where ammonia would not be reactive by itself. You can also perturb the chemistry by adding nitrogen oxides, for instance, or by adding ozone. So we have been following some of these possibilities. This slide shows flow reactor data from our lab on the ammonia NO2 system. So here we have added NO2 with and without oxygen, 500 ppm ammonia, then 500 or 250 ppm NO2. And measuring ammonia NO2, NO, and N2O as a function of temperature has provided significant constraints on the chemistry that the model should predict. So by these comparisons and also by comparison with data from literature, we have been able to constrain the rate constants for a number of reactions like NH2 plus NO2, the N2O formation channel, which we believe is not temperature independent, and there are also some other key reactions. The NO2 recycle loop here, you form HO2, which can react with NO, and to form NO2, and then the reactions of NO2 provide H2NO and HNO, which can then oxidize to recreate your HO2. So there is an NO2 recycle loop. So these kind of perturbation experiments can provide important information about the chemistry. But the most important contribution in terms of experiment, that is the data on ammonia ignition oxidation. And these data can come from shop tubes, rapid compression machines, jet stirred reactors, premixed flames, or from flow reactors. We are using tubular flow reactors in the group to obtain experimental results. No matter which experimental technique you use, shop tubes, rapid compression machines, premixed flames, jet stirred reactors, maybe even batch reactors, or the flow reactors that we are using, all of these techniques have some uncertainties associated with them that you need to be aware of if you want to use them for kinetic model development. Most of these issues are well known for the different techniques, but ammonia is a particularly tricky component because it's so surface sensitive. It can adsorb on surfaces, and it can also react on surfaces. So the adsorption problem may affect shock tube and rapid compression machine experiments because you may lose some ammonia on the surface before you start your experiment. In our flow reactors, we are concerned about ammonia reacting on the surface. So I'll get back to that that issue. Here we see some of the flow reactors that we are working with. Often we just use a single tube where we preheat the premixed gas and then let it react at the isothermal temperature. We can, at atmospheric pressure, we can reach temperatures of up to 1500 Kelvin, and at high pressure, 100 atmospheres, at temperatures up to 925 Kelvin. We also have a reactor design where we preheat the reactants individually and then mix them at the entrance to the reaction zone. Thereby, we have no reaction during preheating. Here's a sketch of our high pressure laminar flow reactor. We have the pressure shell inside the oven, so that limits how high we can go in temperature. But the good news here is that the ignition conditions in the two-stroke engine is actually at 100 bar and 900 Kelvin. So we can access those conditions just under very dilute conditions. And here are some results from the high pressure setup on ammonia oxidation. So we see that under these conditions, very, very lean, 100 atmospheres, ammonia is oxidized at temperatures above 800 Kelvin. This is an old model. The present model will show very little reaction under these conditions. We have a challenge in predicting the correct reactivity at high pressure. Problem with these experiments are that we cannot be sure that they are not affected by the reactions on the surface of the reactor, which is quartz. There's a very important old study by Dean and Lyon from Exxon from 1982, where they studied ammonia oxidation in a laminar flow quartz reactor. And what they found was that the induction time was surface dependent. That means that the reactions on the surface of the reactor could significantly reduce the induction time. The oxidation rate after induction and the NO formation rate after induction was not dependent on the surface. But that means that if you have data from these type of reactors that only shows an exit concentration, then you have an uncertainty about the actual reaction time after initiation. So for this reason, we developed a variable length atmospheric pressure flow reactor, where we have an inner tube which we can take up and down with the ammonia as a reactant, and then we have a major flow with oxygen and water, and then we can change the location of the injection to vary the residence time in the reactor. One has to be careful with this type of reactors, because if you use a thermocouple to measure the temperature profile, basically it only measures the wall temperature. So we assist our measurements with computational fluid dynamics calculations to have a better idea of the temperature profile in the reactor. Here are some results. Actually, the results shown here are mostly from the literature, from Dean and Lyon on the left-hand side at 1280 Kelvin with and without water, the ammonia oxidation rate as a function of the oxygen concentration. And on the right-hand side, the ammonia oxidation rate at 4% oxygen as a function of temperature. We believe that these kind of data are a valuable supplement to the flame speed data and the ignition delay data that are usually used for model validation. We can see that the model does a reasonable job. But if we want to make a status of our understanding of the ammonia oxidation chemistry, we have to say that this post-flame oxidation, this is a comparison with our data, as a function of oxygen concentration, seem to be working okay at atmospheric pressure. Flame speeds, we are getting closer. We are probably within the experimental uncertainty at this point, maybe except at very reducing conditions. But we have a problem with the ignition delay times and oxidation rate at very high pressure in the absence of any combustible. So that is a challenge in our model development. Let's talk a little bit about the co-fuel situation. So basically, we are interested in predicting ignition delays for co-fuel ammonia mixtures. So do they interact? Does that interaction chemical coupling affect the ignition delay time? The shift of temperature regime is that the co-fuel can shift the ammonia oxidation chemistry to lower temperatures by providing radicals. We're interested in the oxidation rate, the flame speed, and the pollutants, N2O, as we have been talking about, NO and NO2, any ammonia slip. But if the co-fuel is a hydrocarbon, then we may also form various hydrocarbon amines, cyanides, and isocyanides. Possibly they are not an emission concern, but strictly speaking, we don't know about that at present. I will just briefly touch on two of these possible co-fuels, diesel, because it's presently tested as a pilot flame fuel, and hydrogen, because you can in situ possibly crack the ammonia to ammonia-hydrogen mixture, and then hydrogen can facilitate the ignition and oxidation. So these are two interesting co-fuels. Regarding diesel, we have in a collaboration with Lund University and Princeton University, we have looked at the ignition and oxidation of ammonia N-heptane mixtures, where N-heptane is a diesel surrogate. So on the left-hand side, we have data at 100 atmospheres from a jet stirred reactor for the N-heptane and CO2, ammonia, water, oxygen. And on the right-hand side, similar data from our own high-pressure flow reactor at 21 atmospheres and 100 atmospheres. So we can see that the model is able to predict these data satisfactorily. We have also compared the model predictions with ignition delay measurements from a rapid compression machine from Yu et al. 2020. And it turns out that there are specific parts of the chemistry that are important to address in order to get a satisfactory agreement as we have here. One thing is that there's a chemical coupling, which is not good news if you want to simplify the chemistry too much. But the reaction of NH2 with N-heptane to form ammonia and the radical, different radical isomers here is required in order to obtain a good agreement. Another model improvement was a theoretical study by Steven to look at the NH2 plus HO2 to have it being chain terminating. So these are some of the major steps that have improved the model predictions. If you look at hydrogen together with ammonia, overall, I think the situation in terms of understanding the chemistry is quite good. Here we have data from jet start reactors from Mani Sarati's group, a different ammonia-hydrogen mixture ratios. Here, data from flame speeds and the rapid compression machine ignition delays. And overall, it looks like the model can capture the impact of the hydrogen quite well. But at the University of Zaragoza, this is collaboration between a number of different universities. They did flow reactor experiments, and they showed that even though we can predict the ammonia oxidation rate fairly well, the hydrogen consumption is not predicted well. We can see that the hydrogen consumption compared to experiment is significantly underpredicted. So the balance between oxidation of hydrogen and formation of hydrogen from extracting a hydrogen atom from ammonia, that balance is not working well in the model at the moment. So that is an issue we need to address. If we look at the ammonia oxidation pathways, they depend a lot on the reaction conditions, the equivalence ratio and the temperature, and also the pressure. In general though, because NH2 plus O2 is slow, NH2, the key radical, is converted by reaction with a radical pool at high temperatures. At medium temperatures, where at lower radical concentrations, it requires formation of NO to become faster. And then as you go to high pressure, the HO2 becomes maybe even the dominating radical. So the NH2 plus HO2 reaction becomes quite important. Also in the reaction path diagram over here, we can see that the formation of NO and the formation of N2O. Let's take a look at N2O for a while, because it could be a showstopper for some technologies. Because N2O is such a strong greenhouse gas, an emission of just a few hundred ppm N2O is enough to offset the CO2 benefit of using a non-carbon fuel. So this is an important issue. This slide shows formation and decomposition pathways for N2O. From combusting ammonia, there's a high temperature pathway, NH plus NO, to give N2O plus H. This would be important in the flame at early stages, and possibly the N2O formed at these conditions at high temperatures would quickly decompose and not be an emission concern. But then there's a medium temperature pathway that could be important at the later stages of the cylinder cycle, the NH2 plus NO2 reaction that we also studied when we did the ammonia NO2 flow reactor study I mentioned before. Now, if the temperature is dropping here, it's there's a larger chance that N2O formed this way is preserved and concern an emission to the system. N2O once formed can decompose by thermal dissociation, which is fast at high temperature and has a well established rate constant. But it can also be consumed by reaction with a radical pool, N2O plus H, which would be promoted in the flame zone. And N2O plus O, which is slower, but under the oxidizing conditions late in the cycle could still be important. These slides show measurements and comparison with modeling predictions for the NO and N2O formed in our variable residence time flow reactor at the different oxygen concentrations. And at least under these conditions, it looks like the N2O formation is fairly well predicted by the model and also the NO. But let's take a look at the N2O decomposition pathway. So the N2O plus O reaction could be important at the latest stages of combustion. This reaction has two product channels, one going to NO plus NO, which is well established, and another one going to N2 plus O2, where there's a huge difference between measurements. They are scattered several orders of magnitude, and also the two theoretical studies vary by even more, up to three or four orders of magnitude, one from Pham and MC Lin, and one from Gonzalez and co-workers, who believe that this reaction does not take place at all, forming N2 plus O2. So we went back and looked at the literature results. And the data that we found most reliable from the literature are batch reactor data obtained at low temperatures, where the formation of NO particularly would be very sensitive to whether we had a low activation energy channel to form N2 plus O2, but also results from shop tube. And we believe that these results to a significant degree proves that this N2 plus O2 reaction has such a high activation energy that it's not important. So the most important consumption reaction for N2O, in addition to dissociation thermally, is probably the N2O plus OH reaction. And the overall rate constant, the branching fraction, still has some uncertainty. And if you want to go to high pressure, there's particularly the possibility that your N2O plus H recombine and you form the HNNO addox, which we don't know very much about. Mike Burke's group has been studying this chemistry recently, and I think it's important to take this into account at high pressure. Okay, I'm at the end of my talk now. I think there is a lot of work still to do on the ammonia-related chemistry, on the ignition and oxidation rate of ammonia, and perhaps even more so, mixtures of ammonia with co-fuels, formation of pollutants, N2O in particular, but also NO, and even the chemistry of the thermal denox process requires more work, because the models are not truly predictive yet for this process either. So I encourage you to keep on working in this field if you have the possibility. Thanks a lot for your attention.